Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Tom Kuhneman, and I'm from Palm Desert CIC, and it's great to be with you this morning. I want to share a little bit about myself. I have an awesome wife. Her name is Kim, and the two of us have six kids. And those six kids range from ages 28 down to 5. And here's a little amazing tidbit. The firstborn and lastborn were born on the same day. Wow. They all have the same first initial A, and I call them my A team. Several years ago, back in the spring of 2007, the Lord really prompted me to just get a real prayer life. And so in that prayer life, the Lord told me He wanted more from me. But what was different from that more request is He said, I want it now. So I had a sense of urgency about me that had me look around. I looked at the church we were involved with to find a ministry to plug into. And not finding a space to step into, I shared with my inner circle, my dad, my brother-in-law, and a few others, hey, the Lord's calling me to do more, and He's calling me now. Any ideas? My dad said, let me get back to you. So he made a couple calls, and he ended up talking to Pat Hobart down in Orange County. And Pat said, you're not going to believe this, but we got this guy moving to Palm Desert named Jim Fountain. And so within a 30-day period of time or so, Jim and I sat down at Starbucks on Barner Road in Palm Desert and started the opportunity to start the CIC chapter in Palm Desert. And within 3 months of that meeting, we had our orientation meeting with 14 guys showing up at the orientation meeting, just sharing what CIC was about. And about 3 weeks after that, we started our chapter meetings that have not missed a single Friday since the January of 2008. Thank you.
Great. Hi, everybody. I'm Becca Ash, and I am a member of the ASU CIC Club. I've been in CIC since the women's chapters were just getting started back in the early 2000s. Was starting a career in residential real estate and thought, wow, how am I going to find Christ in this environment? I can't find my bearings. I felt lost in this secular workplace world. And fortunately enough, I found CIC through a bulletin, a church bulletin. And I, you know, like Tom, I had a need. I knew I needed Christ to be in the center of my work because I wanted to be successful. And I wanted to be happy, and I wanted my clients to be happy and to serve them well. And when I saw that in the bulletin, I thought, that's it. And I remember I showed up and Pat Bianchi was there to greet me, now Pat Dreschler, because she's been married. And I remember those meetings were at 7 a.m. on Wednesday, and I could barely make it till the next one because I got so centered in Christ at those meetings. I learned so much through people. You know, people talk about my youth in CIC, and I was in my early 20s, but I needed Pat, I needed the others that came, Kathy, to help me grow in my faith, and we really served each other in that way. So I took a short hiatus after a number of years with the Women's Phoenix Group, and when I had my third son, decided I can't work in residential real estate because evenings and weekends are game time and activity time with three boys. So my husband and I raising these three boys, we have our dog Charlie, the happiest member of our house. And if you haven't put it together, I'm the only female in the house. And I have to tell you, the men's CIC group feels comfortable for me, which, to be honest, when I was called to the ASU CIC club, it was in June. It was just kind of getting the ball rolling. And I came, and it's the first co-ed CIC group. I felt right at home. I'm the only woman in the house. What does it matter anyway? It's an incredible group of men and women. We started out in kind of what I call the upper room, waiting for that power of the Holy Spirit to come down. We emerged in August when all of the students came back to ASU, and it is a very large university, onto campus. Art said, we got to get onto campus. And we were in the bottom room of the Newman Center, the ASU Newman Center, all summer. And I thought, aren't we on campus, Art? I'm confused. And he literally meant get on to campus. We moved into a lecture hall. We had an opportunity to go to the passport. It's the big welcoming event. And all of the ministries and activities and clubs on campus show up and present themselves to the students and welcome them and try to connect with them. I went to, had the opportunity to go to the international student welcoming session. Later, a week later, they had the local, all the American students come. I think there were probably hundreds of students at the international session, thousands at the American ASU students welcoming. And I remember it was in August, which is the absolute hottest time in Phoenix. I mean, well above 100 degrees. I think it started at 3, and about 2 o'clock, I'm finding my way onto the ASU campus, which I went to NAU, so I don't know ASU all that well. I'm trying to figure out parking garages and different things, and I connected with Art, and he said, well, I'm on my way. And I sat in my car, kind of waiting, preparing, thinking, I've gotten myself all dressed to, represent CIC at this event. I'm maneuvered through all these directions and everything. Okay, a few quiet minutes, spiritual minutes. Got out of the car when I saw Art and his daughter Patrice, who's also a CIC member with us, come, and we're loading boxes and pamphlets and all these CIC materials out of the car, and it's just hotter than Hades. And we're walking in to this big, daunting, and this huge campus, and I'm thinking to myself, do I really have something that I need to share? That I've come here on a hot afternoon, gotten dressed and ready for, suit up and show up. Do I really have something that I must share out of love for God that I've received, that I have to go out to others? It was a great moment. It was a great question. And I thought, yes. And I just kept walking. And that prepared me to answer that yes and to be that evangelizer in that great opportunity. And what happened as I answered that question is this gratitude welled up within me. And I thought, thank you for CIC, for the opportunity that it's given me to go out and to proclaim Christ and to represent Christ among these students. So now I want to ask you all that question. Do you, as followers of Christ, believe you have received something that must be shared out of love for Christ and the impact he's had on your life? Is it a resounding yes?
Yeah.
There we go. This is an audience participation talk. We were just testing all of you.
Oh, yeah. We had a welcoming sign yesterday. Sim, where you can see, hear, and respond. All right. So let's introduce this topic, the role of evangelization in the Christian life. In relation to Christ's conversion in us and through us, C.S. Lewis said, this is the whole of Christianity. There is nothing else. It is so easy to get muddled about that. It is easy to think that the church has a lot of different objects, education, building, missions, holding services, just as it is easy to think the state has a lot of different objects, military, political, economic, and whatnot. But in a way, things are much simpler than that. The state exists simply to promote and to protect the ordinary happiness of human beings in this life. A husband and wife chatting over a fire, a couple of friends having a game of darts in a pub, a man reading a book in his own room or digging in his own garden. That is what the state is for. And unless they are helping to increase and prolong and protect such moments, all the laws, parliaments, armies, courts, police, economics are simply a waste of time. In the same way, the church exists for nothing else but to draw men into Christ, to make them little Christs. And this is actually from a radio talk that C.S. Lewis gave. It was after World War II, and he was asked to please help people. They were in fear. They were disillusioned. The world was in complete havoc. Europe was nearly destroyed through the war. So he gave these radio talks, And tremendously enough, they've been preserved and put into a book, which is a great tool to start with evangelization. Just kind of a nod to that. It's called Mere Christianity. You see, has anybody read this book?
Yes.
I know.
Yes.
Tom and I had. And when we connected that, we thought, well, we're evangelizers. Let's include this. The Gospel of John, chapter 17, verse 3, says, "Now this is eternal life, that they should know you, the only true God, and the one whom you sent. We as Christians have more than heaven to offer a world that is conditioned to choose immediate gratification and disillusioned by the ways of the world, even distracted. We have the Christian way of life."
In Galatians 2:20, which happens to be our organization's verse, it reads, "I no longer live, but Christ lives in me." I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The mission of Christians in Commerce is one of evangelization that is centered on personal conversion and the conversion of others. Through its challenge weekends, meetings, challenge groups, and offer fellowship in Christ, and the constant call to be in His presence in the marketplace, our families, with our friends, and with all people we come in contact with.
Hello to my CIC family. My name is Dan Farrar, and I've been with Christians in Commerce for about 5 years now. Over the course of each week and the challenge weekends that I've attended, I've been bolder in my evangelization of Christ into the workplace. I've been able to invite several friends, vendors, and family members to join. And what a delight it is when someone that you do invite agrees to come. I also was invited by the chapter to help form another chapter in Fallbrook. I think they decided to choose me because I lived close by to Fallbrook. Not really, but actually I was closer than everybody else. But I was very excited about the opportunity to see how Christians in Commerce could change their lives as well. And it's been going on for more than a year and a half, and it has dramatically changed their lives. So I'd like to encourage you to say yes. Yes to doing more. Yes to inviting your friends and your family to be a part of God's kingdom, and most importantly, to say yes to Jesus. Thank you, and God bless.
Amen.
Amen.
So Dan's anniversary is every weekend. We have our conference, and so he's happy to be here on the big screen. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, the martyr who died at the concentration camps in Germany, said, "Being a Christian is less about cautiously avoiding sin than about courageously and actively doing God's will." One of the biggest questions that each of us faces as a Christian is to authentically ask the Creator of the universe, the one who created each one of us with a purpose, with a simple 8-word question. God, what do you want me to do?
In Romans chapter 8, verse 5, it says, "Those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their minds set on what the Spirit desires." We receive teaching from the Apostle Paul in this scripture that calls us to follow the Spirit of Christ, while recognizing the challenge of what he calls the flesh, which concerns our own limited thinking, lack of courage, self-centered stance, complacent faith, disoriented priorities, uncovered grace and power, or disregard for his will and call. To help us discern this question of how to follow God's will for us, to evangelize others into his Son, Jesus Christ, through the power of the Holy Spirit, a few additional questions help. This is from a book by Charles F. Stanley, Living in the Power of the Holy Spirit, and he breaks it down into four great questions. He says, what do you want me to do? The first question. God desires to reveal to you the next step you can take into your own potential. Ask the Holy Spirit to reveal to you specifically what he desires for you to do in any given day. Is there someone he desires for you to contact? Is there someone he is planning to bring across your path? Is there a meeting you should attend or an appointment you can make? Is there a decision to be made? Be open to the promptings of the Holy Spirit deep within your heart. Trust him to give you precise guidance and direction. The second question, when do you want me to act? We often fail because we get ahead of God or we lag behind. For everything that God desires to accomplish on this earth, he has a precise timetable. Ask the Holy Spirit to show you his schedule and his expansion plan. When you act can be as important as how you act and what you do.
Over the course of the last few months, Becca and I connected starting in August and had a number of conference calls. And during that time, I was preparing for one of our conference calls, and it was busy at work and busy just getting ready to take that next step in this journey. And I got a call from a competitor named Bruce. And Bruce and I connected industry meetings, and along with other folks, I've invited Bruce a number of times to CIC, so he knows that I love the Lord Jesus. And so he called me that morning and said, Tom, I just have to talk to somebody that I know I can share with. And Bruce shared with me that he's going into a divorce that he's in the middle of. And on that particular day, he was feeling that the job that he currently had was going to come to an end here real soon. And so he was asking for somebody to talk to, but he's also asking me to pray with him. And when the call came in, I just want to share with you, you ever have those promptings from the Lord? Take this call. Talk to this person. This is one of those moments where I was open to the Spirit.
I was amazed by his availability because it was that morning, and we had connected in the afternoon for a conference call. And he kind of told me about it offhand. I think, you know, those times, they get our attention, don't they? Hey, God's at work in me. God's at work in this day and in this moment. And I thought, oh, I'm going to just pencil that in, Tom. It was a good start. All right, there's two more questions to consider here. How do you want me to act? For everything that God desires, Yes. For everything that God desires to accomplish on this earth, he has a method he plans to use. For every purpose, there is an accompanying plan. Ask the Holy Spirit to show you how you are to accomplish the goals he sets before you. What methodology or protocol should you use? And the last question, how can I best represent you today? The Holy Spirit desires to influence others not only through what you do and say, but also by your very presence in any group of people. Ask the Holy Spirit to give you the joy, peace, and forgiving spirit that bear witness to Christ Jesus. Ask the Holy Spirit to make and mold you into an even greater likeness of Christ. Well, did I mention I'm a student? That's the other reason ASU CIC Club is such a great fit for me. I'm currently getting my master's degree, And I take the summers off to be with my three boys. But like my boys, I started up with school at the beginning of the school year in August. And it's a stressful time. Getting a master's degree in pastoral theology, well, there's a lot of reading. Big stack. And thanks be to God for the technology of it. It's an online coursework, and I have access to some amazing professors. So I really enjoy the coursework, but it's a lot of work. And at the same time, I'm helping my boys transition. It's this beautiful thing that we do as mothers. We're kind of along for the ride and the ups and downs. And I said to my husband, going from end of school to summer, being with the kids every day, back to school, I just feel like I'm switching gears. And he kind of went, what are you talking about? You know, my work days, the day-to-day, you know. So anyhow, it started to wear on me. I was tired, maybe had some anxiety, some concerns about my kids, saw the big road ahead with the two courses I was getting started. And I remember this particular week, it was probably in early September, I could feel that weight. And it, you know, Monday morning started, you know, I'm getting into my studies, getting into to the kids' school week once again after the weekend. And by Tuesday, it had kind of, you know, built up. And on Tuesday night, I was talking to my husband, and he said, you know, you're really pretty negative right now. And I just stopped, and I thought, oh, thank you for telling me that. You know, I just didn't realize how much it had weighed on me. And that next morning on Wednesday in my prayer time, I came to the Lord, and I just said, you know, I am willing to let go of this negativity. I surrender it entirely to you, and I set my will against anything negative today. I don't want to do that, Lord. It was a very honest conversation with him in my prayer. So the day gets going, and part of that day was I had scheduled a pickup from St. Vincent de Paul, another wonderful, frequent thing in family life, all the ages and stages and growing, and we had replaced some appliances, and so they were coming that day to pick up some things. It happens on a pretty regular basis in our family life, and typically when they come, they give me an 8-to-4 window, and in the past, all day. I love that you guys are laughing. Thank you. So typically, when we had done this pretty regularly, it's that method of charity that I know God calls me to be a steward of my things, and they come in the morning. And so, you know, I'm going through my morning, I'm getting into my studies. Boy, it's lunchtime now. I'm zapping, you know, something in the microwave. I'm going to get a quick eat before I get back to my studies. And I had to be somewhere at 2 o'clock. So I just kind of took note of that. What it is, I attend school mass with my children because they go to a Christian Catholic school. So at 2 o'clock, I'm pretty excited. I want to get my God appointment in there with my kids and their school. And so I'm looking at the clock after lunch and going, ooh, it's 1:15 now. Like, you know, I told the Lord I didn't want to be negative today, but I really wish I could get here. Thought they were going to be here this morning. That's not what they told me. But so anyhow, 2 o'clock comes, and I realize, you know, I've missed it, and that's okay. And it was an opportunity to be good on my prayer and to let God to help me to do that. And so I went ahead and made a call to St. Vincent de Paul, and I said, I do need to pick my children up at school at 3. I can't certainly leave them on the curb. So if by chance they come after 3, we need to reschedule to another day. He said, oh, we'll figure it out. We'll get them there, you know. And so sure enough, at 2:15, they show up in their big truck, and there's a couple of workers, and they back in, and I open the garage and, you know, greet them, and they're loading stuff up. And they said, oh, you need to get going, right? And I said, oh, no, it's fine. There's plenty of time for you to do your work. So they start loading things up, and I'm just kind of watching them. Their work, because they have all these belts and these cords, and they strap these big items into their truck. It's just, they're really craftsmen almost in how they position all these items into their kind of like moving size truck. And I'm looking in and I'm watching, they're wearing their big lifting belts and they're big and strong. And I'm kind of gazing into their truck, and I see this sign on the side of the truck. And it says, don't worry about the dog, but beware of the owner. And I thought, I looked at it and I went, oh, did somebody donate that? Oh. And I was like, oh, no. They've come to people's houses and they've been grouchy. Maybe because they've been waiting all day. Maybe because they didn't come at the time they expected or that was convenient for them. Maybe because as they're moving their things, they're thinking, hey, that's my stuff, you know, be careful. Or maybe they have some kind of an attachment to those things that they don't know. And I just, in that moment, felt so grateful to God, to my husband as well, that I wasn't that owner. And very much aware that I am capable of being that owner. And I just thought, thank you, God. Thank you that I was able to surrender my negativity. And I blessed them and got them water. September in Phoenix is not any more fun than August. You guys can testify. Got them water, blessed them, sent them on their way, and just felt good that it was the charitable exchange that it's meant to be when we're serving the Lord. And they're serving the Lord. I wanted to share that with you all. In Romans chapter 8, verses 26 through 29, it says, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, and he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters.
Yes, the Lord desires all people to come to know him and spend eternity with him. In the Great Commission, Matthew 28, 18 through 20, then Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptize them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teach them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of age. It is in and through us that Christ remains with the world and continues to call the world to the Father.
My name is Christian Welp, and I live in Boise, Idaho with my beautiful bride, Jillian, and our six wonderful children. Do I believe that we are called to evangelize? Most definitely, without a doubt whatsoever. As baptized Christians, we are called to bring the love of Jesus Christ to everyone we come into contact with. You know, the words of St. Paul come to mind, woe to me if I do not preach the gospel.
Woe to me if I don't preach the gospel. Continuing in 1 Corinthians 9:22, the Apostle Paul shares his desire and ability.
My name is Christian.
Shares his ability to adapt. He says, I have become all things to all men, so that by all possible means I might save some. What does that mean for us? What does it mean for me? This is Paul letting us know that whomever we connect with, that we should do our utmost to find common ground, to make others feel accepted, to be sensitive to their needs, concerns, and to look for the opportunities to share Christ with them. When we study the evangelization and ministry of both the disciple Paul and the apostle Peter, we see very different approaches. Peter evangelized mostly with the Jewish population, yet Paul mostly focused on the Gentiles, both using very appropriate ways to be effective in their evangelization of those two very different cultures.
Just like the people living in the culture of the first century, we all have the same core needs. As humans, we need meaning in our life. We need purpose. We need love. And we need hope. The good news of Jesus brings meaning, purpose, unconditional love, and hope. Rick Warren, who's the pastor of Saddleback down in Southern California, one of the very large churches, but worldly and across the globe, he's well known for his book, The Purpose-Driven Life. Rick says, our message must never change. However, how we get our message out may. Rick also shares that the message of transformation with a relationship with Jesus Christ remains the same. However, the transformation of the presentation should be continually adapting to the new languages of our culture. In CIC, we are evangelizers. Few of you know about the Fab Five. Every time I see them, and there's at least one or two in the room today, but the Fab Five I refer to are the five ladies that came over nearly 2 years ago, actually a little over two years ago, without knowing a single person except Judy Foudy, that they would come over and conduct and put on a women's CIC retreat. I heard last night from Judy Foudy that they have 17 women involved in that CIC chapter in Palm Desert. In addition, I want to share with you my mentor, Jim Foudy. We talked about him earlier getting together with me. But this last March, we had a gentleman who was called to be at our Challenge Weekend. He drove from LA not knowing a single soul at our Challenge Weekend. The Lord told him to be there. And his name is Peter Chen. And Peter Chen's very involved in the Chinese Christian ministries in LA. Peter, after our Challenge Weekend, said, this has been absolutely amazing for me. I need to bring this to my community. And he told Jim Foudy this. Jim is very gifted in organizing, seeing the vision, and pulling the people together. And I want to share with you a little video clip from that Hope for the Workplace Day of Renewal that they just had this last August.
At this time, we would ask Pastor Josh to come forward and give us some opening comments.
Welcome to the Chorus of Welcome today, and congratulate you on your decision to attend.
And the opportunity to share my faith story with you.
My talk this morning is being stewards of God's creation and a Christian working toward...
Yesterday, all four of those people that you saw on the screen and recognized their faces were in our workshop. So I said, this is the workshop to be in. Jim, we had Jim Hannon, his wife Diane, and John Sloan. And all of those people dedicated preparation time and their whole day to be over in Walnut to share with this community of 100 people that were eager to be at a Hope for the Workplace seminar. And I just want to commend CIC for having evangelization in our ranks. This verse, I call it the 2:2:2 verse, 2 Timothy 2, verse 2. And talks about teaching others. This is the great opportunity for us in CIC. And the things you have heard me say in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to reliable people who will also be qualified to teach others.
Christians in Commerce provides an important opportunity for evangelizing within a fellowship of believers by sharing and leading challenge meetings, facilitating challenge weekends, starting new challenge groups, and attending conferences. So within this ministry, we can build ourselves up to go out and act on that great commission of Christ.
Thank you. Thank you.